Good morning, this is Mia. Ooh, it just changed to 12 noon, so good afternoon. 8:30. 2023, the date. August 30th. US. 8:30. European will be 38, right? Today is, how is it? Wednesday. I'm gonna keep calling it Thursday. Wednesday before Labor Day weekend, and I was trying to wear my white clothes, and I keep going through dressers that I can't really. I have like these little tables and stuff in front of them, and I'm like, oh, there's some more white clothes, and some more white clothes, and some more white clothes. Why are there so many white clothes? Oh, because I bought them from some clearance site online, Nordstrom or something. For my series, oh, I'm wearing black though. Today's been weird. I'm trying to track the storm in Florida. I couldn't sleep at 3:30. I felt hungry, and I felt like worried because there's a lot of homeless people in this small town, and there's a guy that started living right here last night, yesterday afternoon, the parking lot, right outside the bedroom window, and, I don't know if it's the same person that I had seen elsewhere who was struggling, and there's a lot of people talking to him that had some sort of affiliation with a nonprofit, or, I'm taking my glasses off, or what's the other thing? County, government, company, and I thought I saw the person like 12 hours later in the same spot when it was getting dark outside. It was hard to tell, but it was the same place that the person was earlier. So I was watching, what is Survival Lilies? I believe she's from Austria. And I was watching her video for a few years, just a couple few years, and her video, sorry, I haven't been watching them that much, because I've kind of shifted, and I said, ooh, let's see what's going on her side of the world, and she's talking about the inflation and the difficulties renting flats in her nation, and how many hundreds of pounds the rents have gone up in the past few months, and the homelessness population. So you can check out what she has to say and give. She will show some stats and stuff about the government supporting people that are unhoused by giving them housing and funding or whatever they need, whatever. I don't know, because I don't live there. And why does the U.S. get so many millions and millions of dollars in taxes and grants, and they feel like it's not doing anything? I see people go in and come out and don't get help. I've been one of those people. Go in, come out, and you have nothing. And you're like, what am I supposed to do with myself, my kids, and, you know, what am I, in one of my situations, one or at least a part of all of my homelessness experience has been fleeing somebody or something dangerous, or losing my house, even the house I owned, or housing because of someone dangerous and abusive and toxic and narcissistic, and there's people in my life where either my parents or my ex-husband or just the system itself will try to expel people from their home or from something that could be an asset that could be passed down, that generational wealth. If nobody's passed me anything, why don't I start the trend in this family room? All I have now, unfortunately, is a bunch of debt because of student loans and not understanding that my income would be so low as naturopaths, we were told also that, oh, don't worry about it. If you serve some underserved people or you're in a rural area, it's like you can be in downtown Portland and have people come in your clinic that are underserved populations or homeless or people of color or, you know, disabled or, you know, and they're going to count towards your 10 years of public service. So they reassured us, don't worry about it. All naturopaths, when you graduate and get licensed, will be eligible for that. You're going to make at least, you know, $50,000 the first year, $75,000 the second year, whatever, the third or fourth years, full-time, part-time. And that there was a 0.01% default rate on the loans. Don't worry, you just borrow as much money. Our graduates, they didn't default on their loans. There are very few of them that could be because of health or some kind of thing. And you don't realize when you graduate, they want $4,000 going out the door. And you're not even having the board exams taken yet. And you're like, oh my gosh, I don't even have, you know what I mean? I don't even have my board exam. I hear this bumping noise. So you can't even work. And it doesn't even mean if you take it, it doesn't mean you pass it. So it was only offered twice a year. I'm lucky it was offered twice a year, June, because I ended up taking the other one in December. The first one I ended up passing it by ticket in December. There's less people. I mean, I have accommodations required. It's a nightmare. And then took the other one in the summer. I think it's 6 weeks after graduation. The first Sunday. Oh, it used to be like, oh yeah, the first, not Saturday, Tuesday or something. The first Thursday and. Second one has two parts. The first Thursday or something like that in August. That group was way smaller than the group I took the exam at when I was taking the basic science. There's a plan for your lives, guys. God has a plan for your life. Speaking of plans, I shared before that I was in the bathroom at an event and my boyfriend went to this stand and bought all of this, what he was told was turquoise. This is not turquoise. It's howlite. And there's a bunch of it, a whole bag of it. He spent all this money on this. And some lady's like, oh yeah, this is all turquoise. She's like, give me all you got. And he bought all of it. And when I came out of the bathroom, he said, oh, I got you something. I was like, thank you. If this was turquoise, it would be so expensive. I have the chips. These two are like, these actual two, this one and this one, is actually turquoise. The rest is dyed. Oh, yeah, and these two chips right here. So I have plenty of these chips. This lady lied. Turquoise is so expensive. I had some that was a strand for like $80. I bought it at a beach shop, but it was like 50% off plus like another 20 or 10% off or something when I got it. I have it, but it's not here. I have some other turquoise. I've shown you that. So that's a change. Let's jump right into real estate. I don't know where you all are located as far as countries. And when you rent, when you own, when you used to own, and somebody took your money and wasted your money and undersold that property, it's a nightmare that you can't go back and undo what you did. It's like, I mean, if you could choose to have unprotected sex with somebody and you have a disease that may or may not be treatable, whatever it is, you're not able to go back. If you, I know some people that have used birth control, different types, and they did become pregnant, and for different reasons, they could also have contracted disease or spread a disease. So there's times when you are wearing your seatbelt, or you are investigating and making a wise decision and finding out information. I'm a person who likes to read reviews, and you could still either be taken advantage of, things fall apart, things don't work out. So why is that when you make the most educated, wise, cautious decision, and it's like a bridge falling out from under you, the bridge that you've been going to work every day, why does that happen? And why does it seem to happen? It seems like some people just breeze through life, and others are struggling. So the interest rates are high, and the feds are putting numbers down, and people are saying the housing is, prices are dropping, but I told you, houses that I've seen, both houses and or land, some of them are like really run down, some of it is straight up desert with no utilities. I was seeing for $2,000, $3,000. For either a house on a lot or a piece of property, maybe an acre, maybe it's only half an acre, but up until 2019, I saw these lots available. And then through 2022, I still saw them in 2020, 2021, 2022. Now I'm seeing the same lots starting at $20,000, $30,000, if it's an auction starting at $30,000. And it may or may not be the same lot. I mean, someone bought it and resold it. Doesn't, just because I see it on for sale, sometimes I see the sale price, but I don't always know what it's going to sell for. Or if a cash buyer just comes in and purchases it, or if somebody does it on owner finance, $350 a month for 3 years, whatever the situation is. A lot of them I see at the auction is pretty much cash. I mean, you have to pay a deposit, even to bid on it. Thousands, tens of thousands, at least $5,000, if not $20,000 deposit on a card. So I don't know if the deposit has to be cash or if it can be credit. I thought the one Ashland Group, I thought they had credit. They had a glitch the other day and they said no offers or no down payments needed today because we are not able to process them. Did any of my family try to jump on that opportunity? That gives you a chance to bid. I think, hopefully, like, if you say I had to pay $5,000, I throw out a credit card, pay $5,000, and the house sells for $5,000, and I buy it. Do they just keep, I don't think you could do it on a credit card, so then I just put together $5,000 cash and have so much time to get them a cashier's check. So if I bid and somebody bid $5,001 and my max was $5,000 and they won, do I hopefully get my $5,000 back? Like, that's what, like, that stuff, you want to be wise. You put down a bid on something that's not an option, you put in earnest money, you have to follow the conditions, and you don't have a loan. How do you make sure you don't lose your earnest money? How do you make sure you don't lose everything? Mess with your credit, banks trying to do loans. When I went to do the Wells Fargo mortgage, I got a lot of things emailed to me that said, sign right here, you're approved for this amount. And they try to say, no, that's not true. I was like, what if I had signed it? But it's first time homeowners, supposed to be zero down payment, and they were put in town all these down payments, which are gonna pretty much wipe out the bank account that they could see. So they made a down payment, everything in my bank. When does a first-time homeowner or a USDA loan require you to make a 25% down payment? 20%, 30% down payment? I always thought that those FHA, first time homeowners, USDA, VA, I thought they were zero down. I'm not talking the closing cost and all. They're gonna charge for the loan signing $1,000 and they're gonna only pay them $50, all that. I'm not talking about that. I can understand that there could be origination fee, there could be the insurance. I was trying to pay for, I set up insurance policy, I set up water testing, I set up inspection or whatever you call it, everything. I paid for all that. It's taking so long to be proactive and trying to just make sure everything was checked off the list. When I started getting, the bank kept blowing me off, and I started getting late bills from the insurance company that I set up, the home insurance. It's like, oh, your payment is past due. Like, it's like Wells Fargo was supposed to pay someone, I was supposed to get the mortgage, my payment, say I paid $1,000 a month, they were supposed to pay that insurance and my taxes and the other mortgage insurance with my money. So if the loan was only going to be, I meant the house was only going to be about $350 a month plus the other fees. So I was thinking it probably been like $800 or whatever. But then, you know, they're going to tax on a bunch of stuff. The interest was, it was over 30 years, the interest on this place was going to be $3,000 total interest if I had let it go the whole 30 years. And what I don't understand is if I had paid it off at 10 and I'm paying, is the interest already calculated based on, so if they already calculate this month's interest based on the interest added to the principal, and that, say it was $1,000, but if I threw down like an extra $6,000 here and there and I had the principal go down, would my payment in like 5 months, not all of a sudden, so it'd be $1,000, be like $800? You know what I mean? That's what I'm trying to figure out. I don't understand. I told you all that I've only taken one financial class, and that was, microeconomics, and I did bad, and that was in college, undergrad at Michigan State. I did pretty poorly, and that was, I'm trying to think that I didn't have really anything that talked about finances in high school, and I shared the other day that I didn't hear anything from my parents. My parents went to an auction once, at least once, and they purchased each their own lot in a subdivision near, connected to a golf course and a restaurant, like a golf. It was open to the public, and they built this other golf course, the Gals or something, where it was like really rugged sand pits, just like, I don't know in terms of golf, but they made it on purpose like that, connected to the regular golf course, and then they had a lake where you could also rent and use tennis courts. So most people, they build a house, it was a quiet neighborhood, but my parents had bought some land and they kind of really just left it vacant until my dad sold them after my mom died. And maybe it was, no, it had to have been afterwards, which I'm kind of mad. My mom's had it been in her name. I don't know if they, I feel like they each bought their own for a couple of grand or a few hundred. I don't know. It was an auction. And they didn't really tell me the details, but it was pretty affordable considering the type of neighborhood. It wasn't quite gated. Maybe it is now, but it was a small town in itself. So I watched my parents looking at homes, either for the structure, dad like Frank Lloyd Wright houses, or trying to buy land on the other side of the state to actually move to be closer to one of his jobs. So he was talking about trying to buy like a 4-story house somewhere, but my mom couldn't really leave because of her job. Oh yeah, that's broken. I make jewelry, and that's the last thing I want is for my stuff to break. like a little loop right here, bead wire or something. Oh, that's a crimp bead on that one. I think, oh yeah, it broke from here, from the jump ring. So they just like literally just like fixed it. She literally just like slapped it onto this jump ring. I could bend it with my fingernails. That's, I'm like OCD about when I make my jewelry, but I try to sell it online within warranty. If something happens, I will repair it or replace it. But nobody's bought any, so. And I went to a powwow and somebody had that. Ooh, God, I got my fingernails stuck in there. Yeah, I'll get the tools out. I have a magnifying glass I don't really use because I need a table to use it. I'll get the tools out so I don't tear out my fingernails any worse. So if the interest rate is high, I did an average of the place that we're renting in Oregon is for low income people. We lived there 13 years or 13 years, and the rent has more than doubled. It's more than doubled in 13 years. When it was posted and when I moved in, and they ended up charging me more than it was posted online, it was less than $1,000. Now if someone moves in straight, it's $2,400. But we, on average, with the lower price going to the higher price, not the maximum, but the higher grandfather price, over $250,000 we've paid in 13 years. I feel like if I looked at an adjustable rate mortgage, which I don't like, first 2 years, $1,600 average per month for a $300,000 house. And after year three to whatever, or from year three to whatever, it was going to be, let me see, $1,600? It was going to be $1,800 or $1,900. And then it probably would go up. You know, I always, like, double stuff or, like, add a bunch more more hundreds onto any estimate because I don't trust these banks. There's a credit union I saw yesterday that I was a member of, and I said, that's the lowest rate I've seen. The other year when I was trying to buy the house, it was 2.75 or 2.25. And then if you get a 0.25% interest rate reduction, they charge you for that. I don't know why they charge you. You can get this. It's like the opposite of a credit. It's like a credit, but I don't know if you pay $200 or $2,000 for that. Why do you pay? Anyways. My student loans is like, oh, if you do all these incentives, you're going to get a 0.25% interest rate. A partial percentage that's going to make a difference, but all of the loans were sold all over the place, so I no longer was able to have those incentives, and I did not choose to consolidate or move my loan or go to a different lender. They chose it, and they don't carry on the original promissory note that I signed. When I signed the promissory note and I set up the automatic payments and did what they told me to do, I didn't sign any new promissory note when they sold the loan to another lender. But the other lender has a whole new set of guidelines and requirements, and potentially don't even have the full records from the first ones. More needs to be done than this one-time payment, you know, adjustment and all this stuff from now until December or whatever. More needs to be done because it is such a mess. I can't even access my stuff anymore. And I have the same thing with the TD Ameritrade telling me that you need to sign up for Schwab now. Schwab? Like, I had a retirement account with some account at Vanguard or something it went to. I don't even know. Like, I don't want these funds. Like, I feel like I need to shut down the funds. I have a CalAble account I was telling you about. I got a letter yesterday so that I only have $45. I know I had more than $45, but they're taking a monthly fee. I thought I was going to close that when I was going to buy that house. Because you can use, there's authorized purchases, I think healthcare and housing, to buy a house. There's a different list that you don't get penalized. So I feel like such an idiot. And I could imagine going to school 8 hours a day for like 4 or 6 years and becoming an expert in this stuff. I still feel like it changes. It's like insurance. Taking insurance, being insured, having a healthcare provider saying, when are you going to get it straight? When are you going to figure out how to do your insurance? Like, that right there is a red flag. I don't want this healthcare provider anymore. If you have to ask that question, then obviously you have not filled your own insurance or even been involved in the process, because it changes. I said every day I get emails from my insurance companies that I participate in, whether, oh, you need to fill out this form, oh, you need to have all your employees do this, oh, we need records, because we get money every time you do something. We get money from the government. We don't give you money. Heck, every time you send a claim, we deny it. Prior authorization, deny it. Everything, deny it. Or we have workers type make up stuff. You call every day for 3 days and talk to a different person, you get 3 different answers. How does that work? Did your whole policy change in the past 3 days? I can call the same person two people on the same day and get 2 different answers. Like, oh, that person must not know what they're talking about. Like, how do I know which of you is telling the truth? Discern that for me. And then nobody can give it to you on writing. I've been told so many things. My patients have been told so many things. Oh, actually, it's this. They'll say, oh, well, and it's causing a lot of inconvenience. It's causing so much inconvenience that people aren't even hiring me anymore, because they're like, well, when that changes to not be so complicated, then it will be way easier for me to continue your services. That's not even anything about my work or the way I practice. It's all about the insurance issue or the lab issue. A lot of it is the money. I'm having the worst time with the lab course. A lot of it's the money that they want, and they will not. They will make mistakes and then blame me because they typed in that test codes. It's like, I applied in 2015 for you to give me electronic access to ordering and getting results. Ordering tests and getting results. Physically manually type in each test code, each ICD-10 code. All of the stuff I had to type in, my account number and all this stuff, my address, and then I had to fax it to the lab, which I don't even think they pay attention to. They probably shred it. They just disregard it, hopefully at least shred it, and then I had to give a copy to my patient who has to then go print it up or whatever, and then they type in the codes wrong, and then they tell me that I'm messing with the insurance by doing experimental tests. I do not order experimental tests. If I had some of this very dire, that's a whole other story. But we gotta start with the basics, folks. Like, you cannot call me every day on my vacation at 8 in the morning to tell me I didn't put diagnostic codes on a lab for somebody. And when I finally filled out the chart and started handwriting, like, oh shoot, I feel so bad. Who do I talk to? What's the fax number? And I pulled up the lab order that I gave to the lab. And it had every single diagnostic code on there that needed to be on it. And I was so upset because I was sitting here having them, like, they were basically yelling at me saying, I did something wrong. You have until today to get this information. I was like, I already gave that information to you 4 months ago. And I have an exact copy of what I gave you. Y'all workers didn't do it. And if you have some kind of, I don't know, what happens to that lab order that I faxed or my patient turned in, do you save those for in case somebody, one of your employees, didn't put the right test or didn't put the diagnostic code? Then you need to check with that employee who made a mistake. It's like when they don't put whether they're fasting or not. That's very important information. And pretty much for myself and for my patient, I have to go back and say, oh my god, you are fasting, right? Because I didn't even know that was important for a lot of the tests. Like, oh my gosh. Oh yeah, I was, like, for me as a patient, oh yeah, I was fasting, but I see my results, it says I'm not fasting. That's like the first thing you ask. And your test, I usually write it in for what test. In case they go at different times, I write in testing, non-fasting, or fasting. I usually just say fasting for the ones that are fasting. But anyways, I don't do high volume lab draws, and it's not the employees. I'm trying to justify it. It's not their fault that their corporation literally told me that it's too expensive to put me on as a provider in my EHR because I don't generate enough income for them. And I said, you know what, the reason why I don't generate enough income, because I go to another lab where I can upload it online in 5 minutes, boom, done, or less. Like, and some of them, they're not even attached to my EHR, they just had an online portal. And you guess what happened to that lab? I think, was it? No, that was it Providence? I was sending patients to this lab, and now their lab court is now taking over all of their labs. I really? I was going to send my patients to lab court, and then it was so difficult to make the order that I needed to just send them to a different place. Like, if you guys set up the EHR, you have a choice to push a button and say yes. How many thousands and tens of thousands of dollars do I need to generate for you guys? I don't get a penny when I send people to your lab. There's nothing. I get some information, but I don't get a penny, and it's like, so tens of thousands of dollars a year you guys are saying I don't generate enough information for you to make it easier for my patients. So my patients can't just go in and get the test. They gotta carry around a piece of paper in their wallet, or, you know, pull up the order that my EHR had to do. I was putting the documents on, and my patients could see the documents. Now they can't, so it's like, I gotta send stuff in the mail to you all. So I gotta buy stamps, print it out, buy envelopes, it's like, and fax it. And I try to fax stuff, and it doesn't work. They rejected it. This is ridiculous. A lot of time on the phone. It could just be like, boom, boom, boom. And does it, if they don't want to pay for me, they don't want to push the button and say, yes, Dr. Mia can have an integrated system. It would be way easier, and instead of having a backlog, it would take me 2 days to do the lab orders, because I have to pull up the test. Not just the test and the type of test, I also have to pull up and write in the test number and all of that stuff. And now I've seen the employees making errors. If I say, like, allergy testing, there's like 20 different allergy tests. And if I don't specify it in the writing, if they write in the test code, they're gonna draw the right lab and they're gonna put the test code. But I think what they're doing is they're either misreading the numbers, or they're saying, oh, they want an allergy, and they're just throwing it in together. Oh, they want a CMP. They're just throwing stuff on there, and the first one that pops up, they're like, okay, that was, pick that one, that was that, pick that one. And so that's where I believe, I'm imagining the errors are taking place. Because I went back, and because there's errors and not a digital, I have digital copies, but I have the actual digital copy that I send if I update something or add something, or change something. Then it's unfortunate because I print it so I can fax it, and then I have to lock it up in a file cabinet. And I got, but I know, one more ream of paper that I have to go figure out how to find some affordable, good quality paper. So this is costing me more money because I don't generate enough tens of thousands per year for this company. I'm only one person in my clinic. I'm not 103 providers doing labs 8 hours a day every day. So sorry about that, but it would be, instead of spending 48 hours doing one person's lab order, and I have a book, instead of doing that, I feel like, I could be seeing patients for those 2 8-hour days. Like, let's make sure a little bit. This is just general. Yeah, I have some pages marked. So this is the book that's outdated that I've been using, and it's just under, if you add the note pages in the back, it'll be over 1,000 pages. So between this and the online system, I can look up labs online, but I can't order, they won't let me order them. And I went to order supplies so I could draw myself, because that would save a step when I'm in person. That would save step, like, oh, I want this, and this. I'm going to draw up, you know, red top, marble top, and a lavender. If I have to centrifuge it, if I have to do this or do that, I have all that. Put it in my lab box or drop it off. If I'm traveling, I feel like there should be a place I could drop it off. And boom, I don't have to. I just have a sample, and I should get the results in 2 days. But instead, they didn't send me my supplies that I ordered. It's just ridiculous, guys. It's like one thing after another. And I noticed yesterday that the pickup address is incorrect. So I'm going to call them, actually, while I have a chance. Let's see why my little mouse isn't working here. Here we go. Alright, let's go back to real estate. Habitat for Humanity sent me a letter saying that I was denied service because I needed to get income. I sent in about 3 or 4 W-2s, and I sent in one. Alright, I was sending in the checks stubs for my business, and those were, and I faxed them, and I hand-delivered them, and then like a month later, they said I didn't submit any of that, so I ended up printing it again and driving it to their office. I was going to drop it off in the Dropbox. What happened to all my documents from the Dropbox? They had pictures of our driver's license, social security number, our social security card, photocopies, all these check stubs, and I cannot give them any information. If it's a cash payment from a patient, I will not give them that. It's check stubs. Because it's not allowed. I could only give a summary from that bank or something, as long as it doesn't have the person. I've had housing help in the past as a doctor, and they want all that information. And it's like, I have to like print it out and black anything out and then recopy it so that there's no kind of, like, sometimes you can see behind a Sharpie so that it's just literally black. I hate that. They say, if you don't do it, we say you could go to jail if we find out you're making this amount of money. It's like, you need to just wait. I do my taxes in April. Sometimes it's October. You need to wait until I do my taxes to see that I turned in the numbers in the 1099. If you make under a certain amount of money, the companies, the insurance companies, will not give you a 1099. So if you charge like 10 different insurance companies and you ended up getting like 3 of them, you got over 600 or whatever the threshold, you're gonna get 3 1099s, but you won't get them from these companies. So all your records and checks, any cash payments, that is on you and your bookkeeper to report. If they used an invoice system or a credit card payment, it's not up to me to give anybody that information, unless their insurance wants to know how much that person paid, because that's going to be deducted off their, what is it, not the deductible, but the out-of-pocket cost for the year. That is required, and it's not given freely. I have written permission from the customer that I have to keep on file indefinitely. I'm sorry, it depends where you are, about 10 years at least. I'm going to keep it indefinitely. I'm going to make a digital copy. So you don't just freely give it. You have to ask permission from the person, mm-hmm. or their child, the parent, you know, whoever's the insurance holder. As soon as I got that letter, I sold. And that same week, I received an additional, on top of what I already had, I think it was $6,000 to 99 or something like that. And I was like, oh, really? And if you're independent contractor through people, like you do part-time work in the healthcare field, and they write you a check or they send you a payment, and it potentially, if they put like what it's for, or they put the initials of the person that you helped with, then I cannot give that either. And I said, how secure can you get? My partner told me to get QuickBooks. The QuickBooks is now a subscription instead of just a program. And this computer is breaking the Lenovo Yoga. It's supposed to be able to open and close. I'm just opening it every day, every morning and closing. The thing is broken. I'm scared. This whole monitor might break off the computer. So I get to back up the computer. It's ridiculous. And if it's under warranty, they want you to send the computer. So you have to delete any personal files, pictures that are secret, because they say if you send it in for a physical thing that's wrong, they're going to need to have your password. And everybody tells you when you do something, never, never, ever give out your password. But then they're saying they're required. Anyways, this is a bunch of me complaining again. Going back to the land. What would you do if you're in my situation where you saw houses, lots, fixer uppers for less than 10 grand and you try to get somebody to come with you to see the land? I mean, it could be something in a swamp or some house that's on the edge of a cliff about to fall over, and you're like, you know, I'm selling you the Brooklyn Bridge, basically. And there could be a lien or something. What if you want to sign up for the tax sales for different counties? When you see the tax sales and the leftover properties that are unwanted, and potential liens that you can see. But what if you only make, let's say you only make $12,000 a year, and you want to buy a property that's between $2,000 and $40,000? And no one in your family wants to even say, hey, go for it, or good luck with that. They're just like, kind of passive-aggressively like, I don't care, that sounds like too much, don't even talk to me about it, no, I'm not going to go visit the property, no, you're not going to be able to do it, this and that. And you feel like if it is a fixer-upper, or you need to drive out there and go talk to the county and check some stuff. I'm an adult. I have to be responsible and do that myself. As a black person, it's hard for me to go in certain neighborhoods, sundowners, out in the sticks, because I don't know what the vibe is. I don't want to endanger my family members by going out with me, but I feel like if you have a witness, you're less likely to just be buried in some bush, under some bush somewhere. You know what I'm saying? There's some weird stuff that happens when people are alone traveling in places that they're not familiar with. Again, I mean, maybe that's my foot in my mouth saying, yeah, don't try to just buy some land somewhere, but you can see the places are cheaper. The satellite images of one place I was looking at, it's surrounded by trailers in the desert, and so those ones I was not that afraid of. There's some folks looking like they're living. What I was afraid of was the ones that look like they went off on a really long dirt road. And the biggest fear there is if you were to break down, have a flat tire, not have cell signal, be 10 miles from any main road where I'm not able to walk. Why would I want to subject my partner or anybody to that now, eh? What I want to do is caravan, have two vehicles go. And then maybe even, I was thinking of bring like my vehicle and then renting an SUV and going. And having someone who knows how to change a tire and fix the engine and put water and oil and stuff in the engine. Like. So I guess the whole point of this conversation is turning into you need to be more self-sufficient and take a chance. But I've spent most of my life, I should say like pretty much almost 100% of my life, I've not done things I wanted to do that was really in my heart because I didn't have support. Human support. Humans have their own dreams and goals and tasks and jobs and recreational fun that they want to do. So I cannot subject my adult children or my partner into having the same dreams as me. If I wanted to be a dancer and I wanted to send my kids to dance, which I couldn't afford, by the way, and my daughter was a good dancer. If I wanted to subject myself, then go take an adult class. If I wanted my kids to do a certain language or a certain thing and they didn't want to do it, then I can't live vicariously through them. I have to do it. If I had that dream as a kid and it came and childhood came and went, then I need to follow my dreams. I don't know how, because I don't think I've really ever done it, I don't know how to have this conversation with you all. it's like, now, let's go back to the outside looking in. Now I'm thinking, talking about living on some desert somewhere with no electricity, no water, no septic, somewhere that's 3,000 miles away from where you are, like, okay, that doesn't sound smart. Or going into the inner city where the houses are all burnt out and there's rats and probably bigger cockroaches. It's like, besides the big critters, the little big critters, there's gang violence, lots and lots of guns, gun violence. And it's not just this block, it's like, you watch Charlie Bow 3-1-3, rows and rows and rows and neighborhoods upon neighborhoods of burnt up houses where there's a lot of loitering. I saw a special on recovery addiction and somewhere in Europe, I don't know where, in the UK, and the apartments were frequently burnt and they were connected. They were frequently burnt down. They didn't necessarily fall down, but they were burnt up, completely destroyed. And so this is from heroin or injectables, opioids, with the candles used to heat and keep up, nod off, and the place goes up. And sometimes the same people either living there or staying with somebody, the same people will have that place burnt, their place burn up different times. That's how they can dry down the house. And, oh, my friend was hanging out there, now it's burnt. Like, I'm pretty sure that probably happened while they were heating stuff with fire. And thinking about recovery programs and medical programs and institutions with beds and roofs and food and hygiene, and not even just that, but social interaction with others and your doctors and your case managers and your therapists, mental health and drug therapists. I had a home program like that when I got clean and sober and I was homeless and going back into homelessness. I trusted in a higher power. I learned some stuff at church and I learned a lot at my 12-step meetings, and I had been assigned to several case managers, including, like I said, like a regular one, drug and alcohol and mental health, and try to get into what's that one where you try to get your job back or try to get some skills so you can have the ability to work. I got denied that for reasons that were because the lady wrote my task down on a napkin that was on her desk, and she told me to do these things, get daycare, and I did, and I called her every day to say I have daycare now, what's the next step? And she sent me a letter saying that I don't qualify vocational rehab and that I would never qualify because I didn't follow the rules. And I followed every rule. I did everything by the deadline. And you know how hard it is to find daycare when you have no money or you're homeless and you're on welfare required by your shelter. and you only get a list of places, and you can go find the closest ones to your home and school, your kids' school, and nightmare. Every one of them, I want to say, I don't even know if there's more, every one of them was a nightmare. Even one lady, it was temporary, this boyfriend was watching pornography or something. Like, it was just... Just because it's on that list doesn't mean it's good. And let me tell you something. My daughter could speak, and most of the other kids were too young to speak. They were mean, and they abused, and I was reporting this stuff, they abused the kids who couldn't speak, and my daughter told me everything, and so, you know, they're going back. I had looked through windows and watched kids be unattended for an hour, and just cry, and just, it's a nightmare. My kids get injured, sexually assaulted. The state places, I can't even stand it. They make, what, $1,000 per kid per month or something. 2,000 kid per month. Then one place, another place that was a nightmare, there's a food pantry next door, and the food that they were throwing away, because it was too rotten to give to people, they made that into food for the kids. And I used to go to that food pantry, and I used to drop my kids off, and I would see the food that was going to waste in the back, and the daycare would come and get that food, and the juices that were leaking through the containers. They were trying to get that. My daughter said, oh, they gave that to you. We're supposed to serve breakfast and lunch. I showed up right at breakfast, and I said, it's too late. Your kid's too late. It's not too late. Like, I don't even want them to eat that anyway. They can't starve. You know those daycares get extra money for feeding kids. I think it's, was it $2.50 per meal or something? $5 per meal. One lady did this $5 per meal, and she had, what she did was she took a big paper plate and dumped generic oyster crackers onto the plate, and the kids just reached their hand and grabbed some crackers. That was what she got, and she had like, what, she had like her and her husband in there, and it was like 8 kids. So it'd be like 8 times at least. So at least an extra $40 per day, or $40 or $80 more per day for feeding them generic freaking crackers. This place was scary. My daughter didn't say anything, but I knew she was watching soap operas all day, feeding them oyster crackers. Not even goldfish, like, not even like something more tasty, I don't know. And they had surveillance cameras up and down their driveway. And there was a room, like, oh no, my husband used to be a security guard or a PI or something. And I was really shady of what they were doing, because as soon as you went into the driveway, like, before you even get out of your car, like, the kids would be bags on, coats on, at the back staircase. And you're like, how did you know I was here? Oh, we got security cameras all over the place. So what happens if they know every time a parent shows up? What are they hiding that they know? It's not normal. Usually you walk in a place, your kid's still playing. It's like, they probably didn't play because she was watching soap operas and feeding them crackers. It's just shady stuff. My neighbor said this was a great place. She loved it for her daughter, for her son. And taking your kids out of places like that, I lost funding and services because I took my kids out of a place where there was no teacher. And the kids were unattended. And I had to go to my DHS appointment with my kids running around. I said that there's no longer daycare as of today. I left him once when there was no teacher, and then I questioned them, like, oh, that lady's parent is sick, she's just absent, they didn't have any subs. And the lady who was the director was in the room watching soap operas, you I went in to volunteer because I was volunteering and I was supposed to go take the kids down to the church and do Bible stories, some of the older kids, and I sat there for over an hour and there was no teacher in the room and it was just kids being bad, like a bunch of inner city kids. Like, I'm not saying it's something bad because of their race or anything, it was just that they were kind of neglected. It's like there's too much disparity that it makes it harder to teach your kids right from wrong. That's my take on it. So when I live in inner city, those kids would act up around me and they pick on my kids, and I know part of it is because I was always with my kids, or we were coming and going for music, had school events, and when they went outside, I went outside. So my raising my kids was, it wasn't like, oh, I'm just going to spy on you, not do anything. It's just we were a team of three. Like, oh, the rules say that you're not allowed to be outside unattended at any age. So, you know, the 12-year-old, they're like, no, at any age. Like, so every time you go outside, I'm going to go outside and read a book. And every time I turn around and grab the phone or get a bottle of water, kids would beat up my kids, hit them with baseball bats in the back. My daughter's probably permanently damaged from the having them pushed off the top of a slide, all these things. I turned up my back. So those kids were like Tyrannosaurus Rex. They waited till I turned around to grab something from behind me. And they beat up my kids in the inner city. I hate this for my kids. I hate being poor. I hate living in a slum. I hate when they come and say, you weren't attending your kids. You're the problem. I'm out there every time. You got video surveillance? No one else's parents are out here. If they are, it's because they're chain smoking on the playground, which is not allowed because it's a tobacco-free community. And I had that happen at one place, and they came and had a meeting with the police for gang. There's a shooting. The person that's getting shot is the one that's getting blamed for it. No, I was getting blamed because my kids were getting beat up by these kids. And all the teenagers were saying, oh yeah, those kids, what they do is they pick on little kids because it makes them feel like they're big and tough. They're just basically bullies beating up my kids. Why would you have, say, is, oh, 16-year-olds beating up your 8-year-old and your 7-year-old on the playground, and all you did was turn your back for a second and run to grab something out of your car, which you're still outside. It's that they wait until you look down. You sit like this for 3 hours. And I realized that these kids, they watch you. And as soon as you reach back to grab something out of your pocket, wham! And my kids running for their lives. Mommy, mommy. I'm like, oh my God. So I'm taking you to the park on the west side. And then the white people looking at me like I'm homeless in their park. Trying to, you know, I pay taxes. You don't know where I live. Kids' schools here, they get tax money for being students, like $12,000 a year. It's a disparity. You don't see the money. You see people's paychecks getting paid, and it might not even be their fault if they can't handle having 40 kids in a classroom or whatever. It's like the system is flawed. Why does the principal get $250,000 a year based on the number of kids, but then they can't afford the part-time music teacher? Come on now. Close down the library. No more gym class. What do you mean no more gym class? This is one of the wealthiest public school neighborhoods in the state, in the country. And you can't only have 2 half-hour sessions of gym. By the time you tell the kids what activity they're doing, it's already time to put the balls away and get in line before the bell rings. Like, I don't even understand that. Could have at least made it 40 minutes. Like, that's ridiculous. What kind of paycheck does gym teacher get? That gym teacher was racist, by the way. That's a whole nother story. Back to the land. If I had land in a slum, I'd be buying a slum worse than the slum I'm already in, but at least I'd own it. And I could rent it. Rent it out. Or I could just fix it up and buy the one next to it and buy the one next to that and use the equity. And not in the first one, but the second and third ones, to buy up the whole block and fix them up with my bare hands and get this guy and this woman that are living outside of my my door and my bedroom window a place to call home. You got all these reality shows on MTV. How much do they make? You set up a house and say, hey, we have 10 homeless people, and we're going to have them here. We're going to have a case manager. We're going to have a round-the-clock, I don't know, security guard nurse that lives there, and have some other, like, on-call people living in that place next door. And let me film it. Let's bring out the ratings, get some views on the YouTube channel, and actually be able to pay the expenses. Like, my dream is always getting people up off the ground. I'm scared of bugs and critters inside my apartment, but I'm even more scared of them outside. Because there's no barrier. I'm going to make this phone call.